everyone, welcome back to my class. This is Ruman Ali. I hope you all are doing great. In today's class, we are going to discuss about the peristalsis that takes place during the process of digestion. Digestion can occur by certain processes. So one of the processes is called as the peristalsis. Peristalsis is nothing but the contraction and relaxation of smooth muscles. While learning about the different organs that are found in the alimentary canal, I already told you that the wall of esophagus is made up of some smooth muscles. So the contraction and relaxation of the muscles takes place, which causes wave-like movement. Whenever these smooth muscles contract and relax, some wave-like movements can be seen in the esophagus, and due to these movements, enzymatic action would get started, and due to this, the bolus of the food can be digested. So firstly, when we have the food mixes up with the saliva and it turns into the bolus form. This bolus of food, it enters into the pharynx from the mouth, and then from the pharynx it reaches the esophagus. Now in esophagus, the contraction and relaxation of the muscles started, which causes wave-like movements, and these wave-like movements of the wall of the esophagus is called as peristalsis, or we can call that movements as peristaltic movements. These peristaltic movements can be seen from the esophagus till the rectum. The different parts are present in the digestive tract, in esophagus, in the stomach, small intestine, large intestine. All these different parts of the alimentary canal are lined up, the wall of all these organs are lined up by some muscles, and these muscles shows the contraction and relaxation, due to which the food can be easily passed from one organ into the another one. The peristaltic movements that occur in the stomach, these movements are so strong that they are able to perform mechanical digestion. That means the mechanical digestion can be achieved by the peristaltic movement of the stomach. So most of the digestion would get completed mechanically by the peristaltic movements of our stomach. After the stomach, the food enters into the small intestine and then into the large intestine. There also the bolus of the food would be easily passes down due to the peristalsis, due to the movements that are shown by the muscles of different organs found in the digestive tract. So the peristaltic movement are going to be initiated in the stomach, and they are continued till the rectum part of the digestive system. So peristaltic movement that occurs in the stomach are so strong that they are able to carry out the mechanical digestion of our food. But when you see the peristaltic movement of our small intestine, then they are not so strong, they are slow. The peristaltic movement of the intestines are slow, but they can be stimulated by our parasympathetic nervous system. So in this way, different sphincters are also present. The opening and the closing of the sphincters are also because of the movement of the muscles. The closing and opening of the sphincters allows the bolus or our food to pass down from the esophagus till the rectum. So this is about the wave-like movements of the different muscles that occurs in the different parts of the alimentary canal. Peristalsis, in the simple words, if we want to define the peristalsis in simple words, then we can say the contraction and relaxation of muscles that aids in the passage of food, that is called as peristaltic movement or peristalsis. So as I told you that the bolus of the food first from the buccal cavity, it enters into the pharynx. So how it enters into the pharynx? Any sphincters are found in the buccal cavity? No, there are no sphincters present in the buccal cavity, but by the process called swallowing, the food can be passed down into the pharynx, and swallowing is a process that can also be termed as deglutition. So deglutition is a word particularly used for the swallowing process. So by swallowing, we can pass the food from the buccal cavity into the pharynx, and then from pharynx it enters into the esophagus, and in the esophagus wave like movements can be seen, due to which the food can pass down into the stomach, and again peristaltic movements can be seen in our stomach, due to which the food enters into the small intestine, and finally it reaches into the rectum of our large intestine. This is how the peristaltic movements can be seen in the different parts of the alimentary canal that aids in the process of digestion. So once the digestion gets completed and the end products are formed, then that end products of digestion should be mixes up with the blood. It needs to be absorbed by the blood, and the process by which the end products of the digestion, which is utilized by our body to get energy, is called as absorption. So absorption of the digested food takes place by means of three processes. Three main processes are required for the absorption of the digested food. They are passive transport, facilitated transport mechanism, this can also be termed as active transport, and secondary active transport. In the passive type of transport, diffusion or osmosis like processes would take place, where based on the concentration, based on the gradient, the substances or the molecules, it can be transported from one place to another place. It can be absorbed by the blood through the different processes like diffusion. So this kind of diffusion and osmosis, these kind of processes are passive in nature, as they do not require any energy. So what are the different things that can be transported by the passive means of transport? So they are transport of water. Water can be transported based on its osmotic gradient. And short chain fatty acids are present, which can also be absorbed by a process called diffusion. It can directly diffuses into the bloodstream and can be absorbed by our blood. But when you see the long chain fatty acids and glycerol, these long chain fatty acids and glycerol cannot be absorbed directly into the blood because they are present in a large size. They cannot be absorbed by our blood. So these long chain fatty acids first gets broken down into small droplets in the intestine. First, it needs to be broken down into small droplets, which we call them as micelles. So micelles are present in the intestine. When the micelles are formed in the intestine, at that time these micelles are coated by some protein, so it becomes small protein coated fat globules. These small protein coated fat globules, so this kind of small protein coated fat globules are termed as chylomicrons, and these chylomicrons cannot be absorbed by the blood directly. It can be absorbed by the process called exocytosis. So exocytosis is a process where these chylomicrons are first broken down into fatty acids and glycerol in the presence of an enzyme called lipase. Then these fatty acids and glycerol can be diffuses. It can be absorbed by the process called exocytosis. Exocytosis is a process where the fatty acids and glycerol cannot enter into the blood capillaries. They directly diffuses into the blood. So this type of process is called as exocytosis. So this is how the different processes like diffusion and osmosis and exocytosis are required to transport the different materials, to absorb the different end products of digested food like water and fatty acids and glycerol. All these end product of digested food can be absorbed by means of different transport mechanisms. The next one is facilitated transport. This type of mechanism is used by the fructose to get absorbed into the blood. So fructose is a sugar molecule that can be absorbed by facilitated transport mechanism. In the facilitated transport mechanism, what happens? Some carrier proteins are present like this. These carrier proteins are present. These are the fructose molecule. When the fructose molecule needs to enter into the cell, these carrier proteins are present on the plasma membrane of the cell. The carrier proteins which are present, they allows the fructose molecules to enter, and then they transport these fructose molecules inside the cells. This is how the facilitated transport mechanism takes place with the help of carrier protein, and this process also requires some energy. Now another one is secondary active transport, can also be termed as SAT. So this type of transport also helps in the process of absorption. Monosaccharides like glucose and galactose, these are called as monosaccharides. They are going to couple with sodium ions. Firstly, if these are sodium ions and these are glucose, then first they combine, they are going to couple with the sodium ions, and then they enter into the cell with the help of carrier proteins again. So carrier proteins are required to transport these different monosaccharides, and this type of transport where the monosaccharides are going to couple with the sodium ions is termed as secondary active transport. So this is how the different substances are going to be transported. They are going to be absorbed by our blood by the different mechanisms like passive transport mechanism, facilitated transport mechanism, and secondary active transport mechanism. One more point that we need to remember here is these chylomicrons, once they are going to break down into fatty acids and glycerol and are absorbed by the blood, then they are going to store in the liver. So liver acts as a storage for fats. Different fats can be stored in our liver. This is how the absorption of digested food takes place by the different mechanisms. So absorption of different substances takes place in the different organs of the gut, like in the mouth, in buccal cavity, in the stomach, as well as in the intestines. But maximum amount of absorption can be seen in our small intestine. Once the food gets digested and once it is absorbed, now the next step in this process is called as assimilation. So after digestion and absorption, the assimilation will be the step. In this process, the absorbed substances, whatever the substances which gets absorbed by our blood, substances are going to reach the tissues. Once they reaches the tissues, they can be used up by our tissues for the production of energy and also for our growth and repair. So energy production, growth and repair would take place because of the absorption of the substances. When it is going to reaches the tissues, it can be used up for the production of energy, and this energy can be used by our body to carry out different tasks. Once the food is used as the integral component by our tissues, it is used for our proper growth and repairment. The next one is defecation, also a step where we can see the removal of waste product. Removal of undigested and unabsorbed substances takes place through the different organ. That process, that step is called as defecation. So here we can see that the undigested, unabsorbed substances are passed on to the large intestine. When they reaches the large intestine, they enter into the rectum part of the large intestine, and from the rectum, they can be passed out of our body. Now the functions of the large intestine helps in the process called absorption of water, minerals and drugs. Certain drugs, minerals and water can easily be absorbed by our large intestine. And the large intestine is used for the secretion of mucus also. So if the large intestine secretes mucus, then that mucus used for the easy passage of undigested food, the waste product, can easily be passed out through the rectum part of the large intestine because of its secretion called mucus. Some food materials are present which are rich in fiber, which are rich in plant fiber. They cannot be absorbed easily. They are undigested and unabsorbed substances. And these substances are called as roughages. Roughages also enters the large intestine and from the large intestine the waste removal takes place, which is carried out by the peristaltic movement. Again, so peristaltic movement of the rectum is termed as mass peristaltic movement, which is a voluntary action. It is under the neural control. It's a voluntary action, so urge would initiate, due to which the peristaltic movement occurs, and by the mass peristaltic movement the removal of waste takes place. So this process is called as defecation. Our next topic is gastrointestinal hormone. So gastric juices would be secreted, and pancreatic juices would be secreted, bile juice, all these different juices, different enzymes are required for the process of digestion, absorption, assimilation, and also for the process of defecation. Gastric juices and the intestinal juices that are formed, they are under the control of hormones. Hormonal control is very essential, it is very necessary, because hormonal control is required for the secretion of different digestive juices. Let us see what are the different hormones that are responsible to control all the secretions. First one is gastrin. It is from the epithelium of stomach. It is secreted from the epithelium of stomach, and it helps in the secretion of hydrochloric acid and also in the secretion of pepsinogen. The next hormone is gastric inhibitory peptide. This gastric inhibitory peptide hormone can also be termed as enterogastrone, and this hormone is secreted by the epithelium of duodenum, and the function of this hormone is to inhibit the gastric acidity. The gastric acidity or the problems are related to gastrointestinal tract, they can be inhibited by the secretion of a hormone called enterogastrone or gastric inhibitory peptide hormone. The next one is secretin. Secretin is a hormone which is secreted by the epithelium of duodenum again, and this hormone stimulates the secretion of water and bicarbonates, especially of the pancreatic juice. In the pancreatic juice, you may see the presence of water and bicarbonates, and these secretions are stimulated by a hormone called secretin. The next one is cholecystokinin, which can also be termed as pancreozymin. This enzyme, as the name suggests, that stimulates the secretion of pancreatic juice. So cholecystokinin is a hormone which is secreted by the epithelium of duodenum, and it acts on pancreas and gallbladder and stimulates the secretion of pancreatic juices. So these are some of the gastrointestinal hormones which are responsible to control all the secretions of different digestive juices required for the process of digestion. Now we are going to learn about the topic disorders of the digestive system. There are so many disorders that are related to our digestive system. If the digestive system would not work properly, then so many problems can be seen in the human body. Some of the disorders are listed here. The first one is jaundice. This is a disorder of the digestive system, because in this disorder liver is going to be affected. We all know that liver acts as the largest digestive gland. So if it would get affected, then the skin of the human turns yellow, and even the white part of the eye would also turn into yellow color due to the deposition of bile pigments. While learning about bile juice and bile pigments, we have already discussed that two pigments are present, bilirubin and biliverdin. Both of them can impart yellow color. So as the deposition of bile pigments occur, the skin and also the white part of our eye turns yellow, and these kind of symptoms can be seen if the disorder jaundice is present. The next one is vomiting. Vomiting means feeling of nausea can precede vomiting, the throwing the food out of our mouth. So vomiting is throwing the content which is present in the stomach back from the mouth. That is called as vomiting. And firstly, we get the feeling of nausea, and then it proceeds to vomiting. This is also a disorder of the digestive system. If the digestion process is not proper, then we may suffer from vomiting. The next one is diarrhea. Diarrhea is a disorder where you can see the abnormal frequency of bowel movement. The bowel movement is not in the normal frequency, and the increase in the range would also take place, the increased liquidity of fecal discharge. The fecal which is going to be discharged out of our body, it is going to be discharged very frequently and in a liquid form. So this kind of abnormality is called as diarrhea, which is also a disorder of digestive system. The next one is constipation. Constipation is a condition where the fecus retained within the rectum, and this happens due to unavailability of water. If the water is not present in a sufficient amount, then hard bowel movement would take place, and this causes the retaining in the movement of the fecus, and this fecus retained within the rectum. So this condition is called as constipation. And here in the diarrhea, as the abnormal frequency of bowel movement takes place, it causes the loss of water. Loss of water takes place, and this condition is called as dehydration. So dehydration were also a symptom of digestive disorder. The next one is indigestion. If we have more than enough amount of food, overeating, we can say, overeating and anxiety can cause the feeling of fullness in a human. And this feeling of fullness can be termed as indigestion. All these different disorders can be seen in a person if his or her digestive system is not working properly. So digestive system should work in a proper manner. The process of digestion and absorption should be in an appropriate manner so that we can prevent and avoid all these disorders that are related to our digestive system. So here the chapter digestion and absorption ends. I hope it's clear to you. Meet you next class. Thank you.